начинать запись? So good evening, good afternoon, and even good morning to those of you who are coming from the other continents. We are very welcome, very glad to welcome you at the meeting of the Moscow Chat Reading Group, which is a monthly webinar organized by Moscow State University of Psychology and Education. The aim of this project is actually to bring together people interested in cultural historical theory and activity approach and try to build a platform for cross-disciplinary and international dialogue. Actually, we've already organized a few meetings and we started in October 2020. And so far, we've been discussing such topics as agency, building of the zone of proximal development, dynamic assessment, and some others. All the recordings are available at the website of our project and of our Center for Interdisciplinary Research on Contemporary Childhood, which is the operator of this project. So I will share the link in the chat with you. And if you find it interesting, please do watch the videos and comment and share on Facebook or wherever you like. The meeting, our today's meeting, will be devoted to the discussion of the ZPD and second language learning. And today we have two invited experts and one discussant. I'm very glad to introduce to you Matthew Poehner, Associate Department Head of Curriculum and Instruction, Professor of Education from Pennsylvania State University in the United States of America, and James P. Lantolf, George and Jane Greer Professor Emeritus in Language Acquisition and Applied Linguistics Director, Center for Advanced Language Proficiency Education and Research, Xi’an Jiaotong University in China, and the Pennsylvania State University in the United States of America. I'm also glad to introduce our discussant today, Eduardo Neguerella Azarola, ILCE Research and Academic Director from the University of Navarra in Spain. So usually we have around 40-45 minutes for the presentation, then around 15 minutes for the commentaries of the discussant, and then we have around an hour for an open discussion where you're very welcome to ask questions and also to send your questions and comments in the chat. We also have received a few questions from you that we have already forwarded to our speakers. And if you have any other ideas or comments, please do post them in the chat during the presentation. So I'm giving the word to Matthew. Thank you.
Hello, and good morning from the US, from Penn State University. I'm joined by the university's mascot behind me. This is a statue of the Nittany Lion, kind of an important symbol at Penn State University. Thank you for that introduction, Olga. I'm really delighted to be here. I was thrilled to learn about this this project that you've developed and to have an opportunity to take part in it. And along with my colleagues, Jim Lantolf and Eduardo Neguerella Azarola, to have an opportunity to share the work that we've been doing in the field of second language studies and how we've how our thinking has been influenced by the research and theories of Vygotsky, primarily, as well as his colleagues and collaborators, and how we've endeavored to extend some of these ideas into a domain that that Vygotsky himself didn't really investigate empirically, the domain of looking at abilities that develop when learners are studying another language, a language beyond their first, what those abilities entail, what those processes are like, and what the psychological consequences are, what the consequences are for the development of the person. So We'll go ahead and start. And I think as Olga mentioned in her introduction here, hopefully there is already familiarity with dynamic assessment. I think our colleague Alex Kutsulin, who I see has joined us, also did a talk on dynamic assessment. So there's familiarity with that. That's really a big part, a central part to what we're going to discuss, because it's come to figure prominently in the Vygotsky-oriented second language work that we've been doing. It's one of the main areas that many of us work in. So I'll start with a screen share. And let's see, there we go. And I'll go ahead and make that full size. Okay, so as the title indicates, we're going to be looking at dynamic assessment in the second language field using examples from the second language field. But I think also the arguments that we're going to be making are much broader than that, much more conceptual arguments as we engage with the ZPD. And as you see here, with some of the potential problems or paradoxes, conundrums that the ZPD challenges us to think about. And so our hope is that while we're going to be using examples from the field of second language studies, that there will be some resonance well beyond that to looking at issues of development and education more generally. Okay, so by way of introduction, I think this audience likely has considerable familiarity with the zone of proximal development and its various interpretations. So there may not be too much new there, but just to kind of quickly cover some common ground, we've seen that, of course, the zone of proximal development, as it's been rendered in English, or ZPD, is perhaps one of Vygotsky's most well-known contributions, perhaps one of his most important discoveries. And despite that, right, or perhaps because of it, it's also something that has been interpreted in a variety of ways. We have a couple of statements here that we selected going back to the 1980s and even the 1990s, where we see scholars who have been engaging with the notion of ZPD and have started to grow concerned even at that point with the ways in which it's understood and how it's being applied. We also see, conversely, a more restrictive reading that was put forth by Seth Chaiklin, arguing that perhaps the ZPD should only be used in some of the contexts directly referenced in Vygotsky's writings, such as we have them. So limiting it really to looking at the age period crises, and that maybe the concept shouldn't be used beyond that. In a review of all of these various studies of the ZPD, Lois Holtzman suggested that we might identify three distinct readings, and those are listed here. So that the ZPD is a property that individuals have, right? Something like intelligence or aptitude, right? It's a quality of a person, right? A second one being that the ZPD actually refers to this a kind of approach to offering a particular type of support to individuals. And then the third one that she talks about is you can identify instances in which the ZPD has been discussed as a collective, as a coming together with individuals and with an emphasis on transformation. She also, and we think this is quite interesting, Holtzman also suggests that each of these readings, when you look at the ways it's talked about in the research literature, certain statements from Vygotsky and from his colleagues tend to be referenced, right? So with the idea of it, of the ZPD as a property of individual, you may find references to Vygotsky's own discussion of IQ testing. Right, and the idea that in schooling, right, there's this notion that young children entering schooling, having an IQ measure done at that point, and then looking at the end of the first year of schooling, a repetition of the IQ, and looking at what kind of progress they made, relative to the school curriculum, what kind of development that they evidenced, and discussing this in terms of a large or small ZPD. Right. We also see this in some of the earliest dynamic assessment work, where Milton Budoff, who was working in the United States with ethnic and racial minorities, and suggesting possibly an idea of learning potential as an alternative to IQ, introducing teaching into an assessment procedure, looking at how basically an assessment of learning that looks at learning. Right, so that doesn't have some sort of proxy, some other kind of ability that the assessment looks at, and then we can try to make inferences about learning, but setting up a testing situation in which you're teaching something and then looking at how responsive they are, right? So capacity to benefit from instruction as linked to this idea of ZPD and popularizing this term of learning potential. Learning potential, of course, is something that also Ruben Feuerstein in his work in dynamic assessment wrote about considerably. That second one, just moving quickly, the approach to offering support. So we see here, for example, in the English publication of some of Vygotsky's writings, Mind and Society, there are descriptions of adult child or parent child, teacher learner, one-on-one interactions and different kinds and what the quality of that interaction is like, with an emphasis in some interpretations then on support. And so we see that this has led to procedures in dynamic assessment that really emphasize scripting help in advance, standardizing it, and having a focus on that. And then this third one, which I think is really something that we're going to try to explore today in our work, that we find quite compelling, is this idea of collectivization, right? Rather than something that you're doing to a learner or offering to a learner, it's something that you're undertaking with a learner, right? This notion of cooperation and the idea of transformation, of carrying forward elements of what is already present, right? These ripening buds, as Vygotsky described them, but qualitatively working with learners to qualitatively change them to become what is not yet. Okay. And as Holtzman points out, we see this previewed in Vygotsky's writings, where he describes this notion of becoming a head taller than oneself, being beyond what one currently is. All right, so just a bit of background, again, since the field of second language studies is not one that many of you might be familiar with. All of this to say, you've got a number of studies that are listed there. I think the really important takeaway that we wanted to emphasize is that second language studies is a relatively new field. It's often linked to some of the writings of individuals in the 1960s, like S. Pitcorder, and looking at students studying another language and trying to engage in a systematic analysis of the kinds of errors that students are committing, right? So whether it's a speaker of another language learning English, or whether it is an English-speaking student studying a European language or an Asian language or what have you. The field has been influenced by heavily cognitivist orientations. And so this goes back to the work of Noam Chomsky and his emphasis on first language acquisition as this internally driven process. And then you have other names that are listed here, figures in the second language field who have looked to Chomsky in some regard as a model, and suggested that very similar processes can account for second language acquisition, that you need an environment that is rich with input or stimuli, and that will be sufficient to trigger natural processes. Of course, over time, there have been different iterations of this, but there has continued to be a preoccupation with internal cognitive phenomena and with a view that second language development follows a universal sequence, a fixed sequence that really is independent or unaffected by environment, including different approaches to teaching. And it's against that backdrop that a Vygotskian orientation to second language studies really developed. So this goes back to some of the early work that our colleague Jim Lantolf was involved with in the 1980s, looking to Vygotsky's writings and using them as a way to say that if Vygotsky's theory is a theory of consciousness, a theory of mind, then it ought to be able to explain all human abilities and the processes of their development, including the abilities that develop in a second language. And so again, it begins in the 1980s, and then through the 1990s, there's really this flowering of second language research that invokes Vygotsky's theoretical ideas and methods to investigate second language studies and into the 2000s. As a quick example of what this looks like and what this means, and I think it's relevant to dynamic assessment and the zone of proximal development, a construct in the field of second language studies that has generates perennial debate and discussion and so on is the idea of corrective feedback. Again, going back to the origins of the field with concerns over an interest in the kinds of errors that learners produce. So corrective feedback, right? A list of studies here that essentially ask what kind of feedback to learners, what kinds of corrections to learners are going to be the most helpful to having them fix it, right? With assumptions such as abilities reside inside the mind brain of individual learners. There is a kind of computer-like processing that learners engage in as they monitor their language production, notice differences in the language use of others and their language use, and then go about making corrections on their own. And the role of the environment or the role of the teacher can be to provide a correction. So do we want to have corrections that are very implicit, such as one that's discussed is a recast, right? So this would be an example where a formulation, a structure that contains an error produced by a learner is repeated, but in a corrected form. So in English, if a learner says, I goed to the store, right? Go, putting it in the past, goed incorrectly, the teacher might respond with, you went to the store, right? So something relatively implicit like that, or a more overt, explicit correction, and a variety of other alternatives, right? So really kind of studying this, that sort of characteristic of the field itself. And then in contrast, we see with the Vygotskian second language research, some examples there where there's a real focus on not correction, but mediation, which comprises, of course, much more, and attempting to derive principles for how teachers may engage with learners in order to help learners to identify difficulties in their language use and to have a basis, a reasoned basis for correcting and for using language in other ways, right? And so principles such as negotiating with learners, providing mediation that is implicit and then becomes more explicit as necessary, right? And so this again is similar to dynamic assessment, right? Trying to identify patterns and concepts and principles that underlie language use and that learners can then develop an awareness of and understanding of so that they can gain greater control over their own language production. Dynamic assessment, again, I know that there has already been one of these sessions devoted to that, so I won't say too much other than that, of course, the notion of dynamic assessment, of using the zone of proximal development as a basis for assessment that looks beyond an individual's independent performance, right? Their independent functioning, and instead broadens that to include learner responsiveness to some sort of intervention, some sort of interaction when problems begin to occur, right? With the idea being that, you know, if we're looking only at independent performance, we're looking at the products of past development, as Vygotsky would say, right? We're looking at abilities that have completed their development. But if we engage with learners in that area where their independent performance breaks down and we begin to look at their responsiveness, we elicit verbalizations of their reasoning, we help to identify partial understandings and underlying problems, and we look at the ways in which they respond to different forms of mediation, prompts, models, leading questions, different kinds of feedback, then we get an idea of those abilities that are ripening, those abilities that are emerging. In other words, the zone of proximal development. And in the second language, in the field of second language studies, we've done different kind of, we've done dynamic assessment work in a number of ways. Some of those have been in cases of more formal language testing, testing of proficiency, kind of standardized testing of comprehension. But we've also really emphasized the work in classrooms, with the idea being that it's in classrooms where, contrary to what, you know, some in the second language field believe, our view is that the environment matters, that the environment is, as Vygotsky said, not a backdrop to development, but the source of development. And so it's in the classroom that we can engage with teachers and help teachers to better engage with learners, to do that in a more systematic way in order to promote development. And so we've been looking at, you know, and these are just some principles that we've worked out with teachers to maintain what we talk about, we describe as a development focus for classroom activity, right? An openness to moving in unanticipated directions beyond whatever the immediate task might be in order to help learners reorient them to their way of thinking about language and to controlling language forms. We've just listed, you know, some of the, some examples of research studies that have been done. Again, some of them are larger scale studies, such as that produced by our colleague Siona Levy in 2017 in the context of the Israeli, the English language portion of the Israeli matriculation exam. And then some that are smaller scale studies, such as the work done by Rima Ableva and Jim Lantolf, in classrooms and looking at developing listening comprehension abilities, a notoriously challenging area for many learners. Okay. All right, so that's kind of the background that we wanted to provide about how we're thinking of the ZPD and dynamic assessment, the relevance that we see to the zone of proximal development for second language studies, and kind of the backdrop of how teaching and development and so on have been conceptualized in the field of second language studies outside of a Vygotskian orientation. So with that in mind, we're now turning to the work of Valsner and Vanderveer, Renee Valsner and Jan Vanderveer, or Jan Valsner and Renee Vanderveer, I should say, on some writings that they produced examining in detail the zone of proximal development and two problems that they identified. So we'll go through these one by one. The first problem, we think is essentially that they're pointing to a paradox in how the ZPD is conceptualized and its relation to the future. And then the second one is a conundrum, right? And that involves novelty and creativity. Okay, so here are a couple of two different quotes that are that emerge from the English renderings, the English translations of Vygotsky's writings concerned with the ZPD. And we think that this is in part related to what Vassner and Vanderveer are identifying here. So they're quite similar, okay? But we bolded out and or put, you know, in a different color here, the some important differences, right? One of those has to do with potential development or possible development, right? So the notion that it's not a foregone conclusion that development is going to unfold in this predetermined lockstep sort of more Piagetian scenario, right? That there is a potential, there is a possibility, and it, that is contingent upon the continued provision of appropriate forms of mediation. More interesting, I think, is the second one here, and this has to do with how Vygotsky's phrasing has been translated into English, and this verb determine, right, which can be used in a sense of, you know, as it says here, determined by, right, or determined through, right? So so determine can be to, another way of thinking about that might be to uncover, right, to identify, right, that we're identifying it, we're determining it, we're identifying it. Another one of determining can be to cause it, right, that it's, that the ZPD is caused by. And those are two very, very different meanings, of course. And I think that they have implications, right? And so we've already talked about how Vygotsky, you know, used what is essentially a kind of agricultural metaphor, right? Where we are looking at the fruits of development. We're interested in abilities that are ripening, that have not yet matured. Okay, so there he refers to abilities as buds, right? The ZPD as buds of future abilities that are ripening as flowers. And that's quite different from the kind of determining, right? The kind of being done to that you have in a more engineering sort of metaphor that we see in some of the English-speaking in North American, in particular, interpreters of Vygotsky and interpreters of the ZPD. And this seems to be especially the case in this scaffolding metaphor, right? That there is this connection to kind of an engineering in that there is a structure that's being imposed, a structure that's created and offered to learners and then pulled away, right? Quite different from, to go back to Holtzman's notion of that third reading of Vygotsky as cooperation and transformation, right? The emergence of from buds to flowers, right? We see some elements that are there, but then something new that emerges. Okay, so this takes us to that paradox then that Vassner and Vanderveer raised a number of years ago, and that I think is really, really very interesting. So the paradox being, how can we observe the future? So we're in the present and we are looking at abilities that have developed up until the present time, right? The past. But what our interest is in discussing the future, right, and trying to see where development is going. And so that third reading of the ZPD, again, this idea of transformation, it raises certain questions in terms of how are we really able to observe what's not yet there, right? When the future is in fact not just moving towards an ideal, right? But it's supposed to be more than that. It's supposed to entail creativity and it's supposed to entail transformation. How can you really observe what's not observable yet? I'm just keeping an eye on the time. In order to move a little more quickly here, I think this is a nice way that they put it, right? They say, in their words, Vassner and Vanderveer, even though we're creating the ZPD in the present, there's no way in which anybody can study that process, the process of creating the future directly in the present. The development of functions cannot be observed before they reach their final form, right? Until they've already developed. And I think this is the most important part. It's impossible to do directly observe those that are only in the process of approaching their recognizable final form. So a possible way forward, in our view, based on what we've been doing in the second language field, seems to be looking at the quality of mediation that learners require, the kinds of mediation to which learners are responsive during this cooperative joint functioning, right? This collectivization that we aim for in dynamic assessment research. And so one of the studies that that I put up earlier is this is one of the, in which Jim Lantolf was working with Ali Al-Jafri, and they published a very influential paper in the second language field where they actually identified a hierarchy of mediation, right? A list of, as you can see, 12 different forms of mediation or moves on the part of a tutor in the context of a tutor-learner interaction. This was looking at learners of English as a second language and working through problems in their writing abilities. And as you can see here in this hierarchy, beginning from simply asking the learner on his or her own to try to identify problems with the writing while the mediator, the tutor, sat by and was simply present, right? Their presence creating this kind of collaborative framing, right? So we have that from very early on. And then as you become, as you move up the hierarchy or down the hierarchy, however you want to look at it, you see the tutor or mediator indicating that there is something problematic in a particular sentence. And then as we move down, let's look at number six, the tutor indicating the nature of the error, right? So in a sentence, there could be all sorts of problems. So giving an example, there's something wrong with an article, with a tense marker, with an auxiliary verb, et cetera. And then becoming more and more explicit to providing clues, as we see in number nine, and ultimately providing the correct form and an explanation and examples, looking at 10, 11, and 12. So what's interesting about that, I think, is looking at the quality of mediation that learners require and how responsive they are. So if I can go back, it tells us something quite different if a learner responds to, say, level 2 mediation than level 10 mediation, right? And what kind of response do they have? Do they respond by being able to identify the error, or do they respond but not correct it? Do they respond by both identifying it and correcting it? Do they respond by identifying the error but then producing another error in its place? Right, all of these different possibilities, looking at responsiveness, that relationship between what a teacher or tutor or guide, right, is able to do with regard to mediation, creating mediating possibilities, and the ways in which learners are responding to that relationship being, we're thinking, a possible way forward for looking at that paradox of trying to glimpse the future, glimpsing ripening abilities in the present. All right, I I'm going to stop sharing for just a moment there because I'm looking at the time and I want to make sure that Jim has time to move into the second portion here. So I think maybe, Jim, we don't want to go through the data example from that study.
Which data example?
We had some additional details from that study before moving into problem two.
Yeah, I want to say something about. So can okay. I share screen now?
Yeah, great.
Okay, so. All right, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So going back to the study that Matt just mentioned by Ali Al-Jafri, which was an early dissertation that I had the pleasure of supervising back in 1992, scale of mediation that was presented, that Matt presented, that 12-level scale, actually 13 levels because it was zero, Ali had this idea that one of the ways of possibly glimpsing the future, and this I want to stress is really just a new idea that we're playing around with. We're not sure yet that this will work. And so one of the things we'd like to hear from you all is what you think of this notion of a possible way of at least getting a glimpse into the future. So Ali had this idea that you could organize learners' responses on this five level scale, in which level one, which would be the lowest, where the learner doesn't notice anything that they've done wrong, is incapable of correcting it, and even with intervention, they're not able to do anything. So basically, they almost just don't have a ZPD for this particular feature. At the next level too, you can get noticing that they did something wrong, but unable to correct it, and they require intervention and so on, all the way up to level five, which is then an independent function that the learner basically understands the concept, can use it and can correct their own mistakes, to basically self-repair. So if you look at, just take the example of one learner, what we're calling learner N, for the feature of how to use English articles, you can see that on this table that you get these shifts in performance of the learner across time. So week one, week five, week six, and the protocols are just the different interactions that the learners have with the tutor, which is not relevant to our discussion here. But what is relevant is the number of moves that are required, how many interactions there are between the learner and the tutor. And the next column, the move sequence, you can see that at the very beginning, there is a large number of sequences necessary moving from level two all the way down to level 11. And level two being the most implicit, which doesn't help the learner, they can't react to that, all the way down to level 11, which is a very explicit level of help. And so we could say that for this learner at week one, there is in some sense no future, right? So the ZPD, the final column, that gives you a glimpse into the learner's future. If you go to week, so the next level down, week five, you can see that the learner is beginning to develop some capacity to use the article system of English, which is quite complicated, as many of you know. And so you can see the future now becomes, in a sense, brighter, that we're now at a level four. And if we go back to the chart, you can see that level four, the learner is noticing, correcting, and with a minimum of intervention, he can resolve the problem. So I think what you're seeing here is potentially a possible way of looking into the future in terms of how the learner notices and responds to the problems that they're encountering in their own performances. So this is our thinking, that this might be a way of having some glimpse into what is in the process of developing. And so as you go from lower numbers to higher numbers, you get a better glimpse into the future in terms of what is ripening, what is budding, what is flowering, as Vygotsky might say, right? So that's our idea of how to potentially solve the paradox of how do you get a glimpse into the future. The second problem, I think, is in some ways a bit more interesting. And this is what we label a conundrum. And this has to do with this notion of how Vygotsky talked about imitation and internalization. So Vygotsky made it clear that internalization through imitation is not a copy process, but it's a transformational process. The learner transforms the model in some way, and they create something new through the process of internalization. And so this presents this conundrum of how can you glimpse the future when in fact the future itself, in some sense, is transformative. And so if the tutor is, or the parents or whoever is guiding the learner, is in fact moving them toward the appropriation of a model, the internalization of some model, and the learner is in fact engaging in transformative activity, how is that possible, right? How can you have both a known future that's at the same time transformative? So we have a possible way of overcoming this problem, and that's what we'd like to present to you now. And that is, I think we have to allow for both the achieving of the model, and at the same time, allowing for the unpredictable and unobservable future that is transformation and creativity. And the analogy that we want to use here is how someone becomes an expert chef. So if you take a novice cook, we won't even call them a chef, right? One of the minimal things you have to know how to do is how to follow a recipe, and how to make an omelet. One of my son-in-laws is in fact a chef in New York City, and whenever they give you a test to see if they're going to hire you, they always ask you to make an omelet. And so minimally, you have to be able to follow a recipe and make an omelet. And that's basically bringing the past into the present. But to be a really good chef, you have to understand something about the chemistry of food, and you have to be able to create something new. That is, you have to bring the present into the future. So what they often do is, once they find out that you can make an omelet, they then give you a whole bunch of ingredients and they say, make us something that tastes good, right? Now, if you're a novice, if you don't know how to really cook, you have no idea what you're doing. You're just putting together ingredients and you know, you hope for the best. But somebody who really understands cooking as an expert can transform these ingredients into something very tasty, right? So our idea is that the zone of proximal development must include both recipe following and omelet making, and this creativity, this ability to put together ingredients that you may have never had to put together before in a way that's creative and transformative and imaginative. So our idea is based on another dissertation that I directed several years ago here at Penn State. And I'm going to give you an example, and I know it's on Spanish, but we've translated it into English for those of you who don't know Spanish. I'll just give you a little example of sort of what I'm talking about. So if you take the concept of boundedness in language, now boundedness is a really important feature of language, and it's a very important feature of reality. So there are certain things in the world that are bounded by nature, and there are certain things that are unbounded by nature, right? So if we take the example of an apple is bounded, it has a boundary, right? You can see the boundaries of an apple. You can hold an apple in your hand because it's bounded. It's an object that has a particular shape and structure to it. But if you take something like water, it's really hard to hold water in your hand, right? It just sort of drips through your fingers. And that's what we would consider to be an unbounded object. So there are naturally unbounded objects, and there are naturally bounded objects. And on the other hand, it turns out that you can take an unbounded object and you can make it bounded by putting it in a container like a glass. So you can put water in a glass and then it becomes bounded. And you can actually take an apple and you can make it unbounded, as for example, what might happen if you have an apple lying in the road and a car runs over it, it becomes smooshed and it spreads all over the road. And it becomes, in that sense, unbounded. And we say in English, there's apple in the road, not an apple, but apple on the road, right? And that makes it, in a sense, unbounded. And it turns out that this also happens not just to objects, but to events. So certain events can be bounded and certain events are naturally unbounded. So if you take the example of jump, so someone who jumps is engaged in a bounded event. There's a beginning, a middle, and an end. There's a certain structure to it, right? You start with your feet on the ground, you move into the air and your feet come back down. And then we say the person jumped. On the other hand, something like running is an unbounded event because you can potentially run forever if you have enough energy. There's no necessary end point into the event of running. So it works basically the same way as apple and water. Only now we're dealing with time instead of objects. Okay, so what does grammar do? Grammar then allows us to take something that's normally bounded and make it unbounded and vice versa, just like we saw with the apple and the water. You can bound water by putting it in the container. You can unbound an apple by smooshing it out. And you can do the same thing with grammar. So that allows a speaker to override the inherent aspect of an event in order to bring a specific temporal perspective to the discourse, right? So what we're thinking here is the first part of the ZPD would be learning about the bounded and the unbounded nature of events and objects. And that's something you minimally need to know. That's similar to a chef knowing how to follow a recipe and make an omelet. But once you understand the concept, that once you understand how grammar works, then you have the potential of, in fact, overriding what would normally happen and create something that's imaginative and that's transformative and that's unanticipated. So here's a little example of a student from this class that Yanis Prieto directed. And what you see here in red, that I bolded in red, is the use of Spanish aspect, the past aspect. And everything you see in red, you would normally, where you see imperfect, you would normally use a perfect. That is, where you're seeing here an unbounded event, which is imperfect, that the student created, you would normally, probably more frequently, see a bounded event, which is a perfect aspect, right? And you can see, for those of you who know Spanish, I've given the Spanish on the bottom. So the idea here is that the learner understands the concept of boundedness of time, and she's intentionally, in some sense, violating that concept to create a particular, to evoke a particular way that the listener or the reader will understand what's going on, right? So she's creating something kind of novel, kind of new, right? And this it continues here. So where you see preterite, which is for bounded events, you would normally see perhaps some imperfect, unbounded. And Emma, which is a pseudonym, is aware of this. She understands that she's created something new. She says, although a lot of my paper could have been written in either imperfect or preterite, I tried to use each tense, she means aspect, strategically to convey different meanings. When I was talking about the moments when we were in the dining room in silence, I used the imperfect to depict everything as if the reader was there in the middle of the action, seeing everything as it was happening. That's the impression that you get when something is in this unbounded aspect in Spanish, that it's still going on, that you're in the middle of it. And so she was creating something new and transformative for the reader. When I went to my mom's room to see her after I found out that she was sick, because the story is about the children learning that the mother was had a serious illness, she used the preterite for all the verbs. This time I wanted to show each action as a complete act. So she's now, if we go back to the chef analogy, she's now creating something new because she understands how the concept works, okay? So our idea here is then that following along with Karpov and Leontiev and other scholars, that development happens in sort of two domains. It happens at the level of understanding, that is conceptual knowledge, knowing how, if we go back to the food analogy, how different foods can be combined in different ways to create particular tastes, particular impressions on the diner, right? And then the ability to actually use that knowledge to actually create something new, right? So our notion is that what we need to begin to work on is this idea of what we're calling creative assessment. That is, the ability to, first of all, master a particular concept like verbal aspect or how to follow a recipe. And then secondly, taking that knowledge and making something new with it. So that's our idea can I end the screen share now? So our idea is to that the ZPD and dynamic assessment is able to get a glimpse into the future. If we think of the future in terms of the ability to achieve a particular model, and then we have to carry it further into the future. And that idea then is the transformative, the creative aspect of the future, right? So we need to mediate learners into mastering something, but then taking that mastery and moving it in creative and interesting ways that would meet Vygotsky's idea that development and internalization and imitation is not just about copying, it's about transforming. But to transform, you already have to have something. That's the idea. Just like as I going back to the cooking recipe, right? You have to know how to make an omelet to be able to make other things. You have to know how to follow a recipe to be able to make things that are really new and create a different kind of impression on the diner. Same thing with language. We need to understand how language works to be able to make it work for us, right? And to create these kinds of impressions that we want to create in our listeners. So it's not just, you know, following the rules. It's in some sense, you know, breaking the rules. It's moving beyond the rules. But if you're going to do that, you have to know what the rules are, right? And so we think that this might be a way of responding to Valsinger and Vandenberg's worry about, you know, predicting the future, observing the future, and at the same time, transforming the future. So that's our idea.
Thank you very much. That was extremely interesting, absolutely enchanting. I'm giving the word to our discussant. Please, Eduardo, you're welcome.
Okay, let me share my screen. Okay. Can you see it now?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. Okay, so thank you, Olga, for the invitation. Well, it's here. Good evening. Well, good afternoon for Spanish time. I think it's 1 hour less than Moscow. It's almost 6 p.m. And thank you to Matt and to Jim for the presentation, and also for inviting me, and for, you know, these last few weeks I've been thinking about these issues. And I hopefully I will give you some ideas and some questions for discussion. There were many issues in Matt's and in Jim's presentation. The first one that I want to talk briefly is the issue of translation and different versions from Vygotsky's original Russian to different versions in English, and there is quite a is considerable discussion in the field if the originals or if the original text is distorted in the translation, which seems to be the consensus. In my personal view, and this is something that maybe we want to talk later, I like Borges, which is an Argentinian writing, one of his claims, and when he's talking about his own work, and he says, my originals are unfaithful to the translations, meaning that text, there is this connection between text, and it's not always, and this may surprise you, but it's something that I want to talk to you later, because to me the key, and I think is not so much what is the original sense, which is hard to know from, you know, Vygotsky's group's writing in the 1920s and the social situation at the time and the historical political context. I think that to me the key is if a different interpretation of the CPD is opening new ways for teaching and for learning. And I think new interpretations also, they illuminate new understandings of what could be the original understanding of the CPD. So that's something that maybe we can talk later. About the two issues that Jim and Matt were saying, one is the issue of the paradox. Can we observe the future if we are always in the present? My personal answer to that will be connecting to Yuri Lotman and his notion of the semiosphere. And I don't know if this is something that Matt or Jim is something that connects to, but I mean, one of the things that Yuri Lotman says is that we are born into five dimensions, not only four, right, which is the spatial ones and time, but a universe of symbols and of meanings. And I think in the paradox that Walsinger and Van der Veel, what they are arguing, I think they are forgetting, if I can say that, the semiosphere. I think we can travel into the future because we come into a universe of symbols and representations and basically semiosis, right? And I think that's something, that's one way also out of that paradox, because if you only consider present times as the physical side, like other species, then of course, you know, we're always in the present and that's it. But if we think about the semiosphere, which is Yuri Lotman's argument and it's been made by other people, then you can travel through time and space. And I was even thinking now with these new technologies, with Zoom and digital communications, we can travel through space, but it's a representation. We're engaging with images that are representations of ourselves, but we're indeed traveling through space. We're doing something right now that is impossible in the physical universe because we're working with representations, which is these images and screens and the sounds, right? So it's possible to travel through space as we are seeing right now. It is also possible to travel through time, right? Now the implications is what do we do this in practice? But I think that's something, at least to me, is one consideration. Now, my presentation goes to the other issue that Jim and Matt were bringing up, which is the issue of creativity. Let's see. Right, and that's where I have a few slides, right? And I wanna talk about these two questions and really talk about the notion of creativity that Jim and Matt were hinting. And I wanna offer you these two questions. The first one is how teaching learning is constructed in the classroom through the activities, the questions, and the example that we bring, and what is the potential development of these very activities? And I will give you an example. And number two, I think for Jim and Matt, if you are gonna push for creativity, you also have to define creativity in very specific terms, which you have done, but I think there is a little bit more that we can say, and then maybe we can have a discussion and see what you think. So the first question actually, I'm going to give you an example with my daughter. This is my daughter, Elsa. She was six. And I want to use an example related to first language learning. I have more for second language learning, but I know some of you that you work in education and psychology. So I think this is a really good example. and how when we have textbooks, when we bring materials to the classrooms, I don't know if we think about the implications, not only of the explanations, but the very activities, the designs, the drawings, the questions, the tasks, everything that goes in there, right? Okay, so let me give you, this is in Spanish. I think I have the English version for this too. She was asking me in Spanish, Papá, ¿cómo duermen los delfines? Right, which is Daddy, how do dolphins sleep? Which is not in the book. I will explain you what is in the book. I think I have it in my next slide, right? So this is an example I wanna give you to talk about creativity, which is not about second language learning. Then we can talk about second language learning. So this is from a Spanish book for kids that are six. My daughter was six last year. And since we were in with COVID, she was being homeschooled with us, and I have the option of seeing the books. So this activity that you have is basically you need to categorize animals in, you know, mammals, birds, and fish, and they do different activities. So in the first one, they make you think about if they have wings, or, you know, if they have fins, the aletas, and if they swim. But they give you a whale, so you're beginning to see the trick. They give you before they have done fish, and, right? So they do different activities, but then they realize that, for instance, a dolphin is not a fish, although it looks like a fish, right? So this is quite challenging for my daughter, but we were able to do that. Now, the interesting question for me was,
how do dolphins sleep?
Right? You hear that? Which she just came up with that, right? And I didn't know the answer to that, right? And I can assume she was thinking, okay, so if the dolphin is not a fish, it's a mammal, right? They breathe, but mammals, we also sleep, right? So if you are underwater and you're a mammal and you need to sleep, then what do? Right? Which I didn't know. I have to go up and I Googled this up in National Geographic. And as it turns out, it's a pretty big issue that's been researched because they remain half conscious and they have one eye open, the other one. Now, to me, what was fascinating in this question was that it was a functional question, which was based on the taxonomic question, which was based on the noticing question, right? So this is something that related to the practice of teaching, general teaching, and that maybe we don't think as much as we should, right? So we have these noticing questions when we think about creativity. Do dolphins walk, swim, or fly, right? They swim, right? But it's not gonna help you with the taxonomic question, because, you know, if you think they swim, then it's a fish, right? Now, the taxonomic question, the scientific thinking, is going to be, are these mammals, birds, or fish, right? But I like her question, and I've been thinking a lot about this issue related to creativity, and that's what I'm calling a synthetic question, right? What is this genuine thinking, right? You are thinking through issues, right? You are taking the dolphin is a mammal issue, and then you're going to drown, right? Now, I think, of course, this has a lot of implications for second language teaching, for the praxis of second language teaching. And Jim and Matt, they were talking more about the second language learning. And one of the things related to creativity that we need to consider in research is be careful about the questions we ask and how, in this case, knowledge, but also in my case that I teach Spanish, how is language being constructed, right? If you say, is this an ending in Spanish? Is this a conjugation? Is this a prefix, right? That's one type of question when you teach grammar. A different one is this a noun or a verb, right? If you do meta-language grammar. But I think concept-based teaching is about something more. It's about thinking through the issues, right? And that's where the creativity, I think that's what Jim was saying at the end. It's not just mastering, in the case of Spanish, aspect. It's really thinking about a narrative in a different way, and that you actually may break the convention, which is using the imperfect for describing the preterite for narration, right? So that's, to me, is for the practice of teaching, right? And I'm sure some of you may have an insight. Now, question number two is that I have for you is, how can we understand creativity to frame teaching learning through creativity, right? And I think the problem usually is that creativity is connected to either what I have there, artistry, right? You are creative if you have a gift, or to novelty, right? This is something totally new, or to being unique, what you're offering is really, right? And I think from this perspective, connecting to what they were presenting, is about transformation. And I think the way that I've been thinking about this issue is that it's not just about being, it's about becoming, right? It's not just about self-expression that we do, it's also about self-exploration. And you gotta have these contradictions between what I wanna say and what I give you to say this thing. So it's not just anything goes, there needs to be some tension, right? And we see that in the field of second language learning. We're teaching now, I'm teaching in Spain, Spanish, and we have learners from all over Europe and from the US. And there's always a contradiction in a second language between who I am and my personality in the language that I master, and then wanting to say different things in Spanish, right? But the issue is not about the morphology. It's not just about being accurate, right? That's an origin question. And it's not about, when you are in Spain, about the meta language, right? It's about your identity. It's about, I wanna be funny in Spanish. I wanna be serious. I wanna look intelligent. I wanna make friends. Right. So that's one way of thinking about creativity, I think, that is coherent with what Jim and Matt they've been presented, right? So the takeaway from a teaching praxis perspective is two things. I mean, there are many more, and these can be developed longer, but I just have a few minutes. I think that one of the easiest way to do this in teaching, and now in talking about adults, is engaging with art-grounded teaching, right? We do this with kids, right? Where you have storytelling and theater and design and, right? Well, at least there are schools where you have those options. But when you get to a certain age, when you get usually to, and I'm seeing that with my son, to sixth grade, seventh grade, then it's all about analysis. Now we just gotta do analysis, unless you go to art school, right? And if you get to a university, it's even worse. We teach language through analysis and repetition, as if that were the dominant way of learning, which it is, but there are other ways, right? And I think that's at least what we've been trying to do these last few years here. And then you gotta be, you know, when you have a seminar, or when you have a discussion about reading, think a practical implication to promote the CPD is think about the questions that you're asking. Are these noticing questions? Are these, you know, meta questions? Or are these functional questions, right? So that's what I have for you for thinking and having a discussion. I wanted to be brief. You know, Olga, I give you.
Thank you very much. It was indeed very, very interesting, and I think absolutely full with ideas and discussion stimulating. So we have actually two options. We can first, this is up to the speakers, up to Matt and James and Eduardo, also up to you. We have questions in the chat. Seven of them were sent in advance. So Matthew and James, you have seen them earlier. So we can start with these questions if you'd like to, but we also have a few new questions that appeared in the course of your presentation. So you could also address these questions in the first step if you'd like. And then we can proceed to the open discussion. So if somebody wants to ask something, we can also do it right away. So please, it's up to you, Matthew.
Great. Thank you, Olga. So I just opened up the chat. I didn't see before that there were questions in there. So I'm just looking at that now. And I don't know if Eduardo and Jim, if you can see the questions in the chat. Let's see. So so maybe I'll just start with one of the questions that was sent to us in advance that we had a little bit of time to think about. So this was the question was that there's been discussion that Vygotsky's definition of the ZPD takes a linear perspective. And asking us, you know, what we thought about that. I actually think that that's really, really directly connected to what we were looking at with the different readings of the zone of proximal development and how we look at that term, you know, again, rendered in English as, you know, the possibility or potential in those translations. So, I think that if it is approached in a strictly linear kind of way, that would, you know, necessarily delimit how we would think about what comes next. And so, depending on how you want to look at this, focusing on something in a linear way, to my mind, would emphasize perhaps that one kind of development that we were talking about, that as Jim was suggesting, we might think about as following a recipe, right? Or are you, you know, how closely are you working toward the ideal, right? So kind of the given form, how closely are you working toward the, if we think of it in terms of language, sort of, you know, the norms, the conventions, the standards, right, that we might, that are going to be an important part of being able to control those, right? But it leaves aside that other interesting part, right? That other important part, which has to do with creativity, right? Because then that whole linear piece, you don't know exactly what's going to come next. It might be, as Eduardo was suggesting to us, it might very much be a tension between self-exploration and connection with others, right? It might be a kind of creativity that manifests in the sort of questions that we ask, like in Eduardo's example of your daughter's question, that sort of the text that she was given provided a springboard for a set of connections, right, that went beyond that and actually went in a new and unanticipated direction. So I think that would go against a very linear way of thinking about the ZPD. I don't know if Jim or Eduardo, if you want to add either to that or look at any of these other questions.
I actually think that, and we wrote about this in a paper that we recently published. One of my students from China, Xi Zhao, and I published a paper in the Journal of Theory of Social Behavior on the ZPD and challenging this notion of scaffolding as a way of interpreting it in favor of the agricultural metaphor that Vygotsky actually used, budding and flowering and fruits. But I think if you read through Vygotsky's writings, I think you could make an argument that, although he didn't call it ZPD, that the idea of this mediation and this future orientation is always there in his work. I think if you look at, for example, the paper on instrumental method and what he writes about what he called variously the double stimulation and the method of of, well, double stimulation and experimental developmental method, as you sometimes called it. I mean, the ZPD is clearly implied in there. It's about giving people tasks in laboratories or in school settings that they can't do, and then giving them forms of mediation, different forms of mediation, to see how they react and how they can achieve the task that they can't otherwise do on their own. I mean, it seems to me that's kind of at the core of what the ZPD is all about. I think, you know, a lot of people write about Vygotsky, the ZPD, as something that developed later in his writings, but I actually think the core of it, the fundamental idea of it, is there almost from the beginning, from really early on. The other thing I wanted to comment on is Vygotsky, you know, had this extensive paper on creativity and imagination. Published in the Journal of Russian East European Psychology. And he writes in there about creativity in children as they develop through adolescence and in school. And one of the interesting things to me that he says in there is that creativity is imagination that's turned toward reality. So it's about doing something. It's not just sort of daydreaming. It's not just thinking up something new. It's actually doing something that is impactful. And when you're confronted with this dissonance between what you're capable of and how you're thinking, with something that butts up against that and that creates this problem, this dissonance that you need to deal with, you can either turn away from it or you can actually embrace it and try to do something about it. And that's when I think creativity becomes relevant, right? And that's what I think that the example that we gave of this student, Emma, was doing, right? She was taking something she already knew and she was creating a reality for a reader or a listener. That drew the reader or listener into the story in ways that are quite different from what you would normally anticipate, how aspect is used in Spanish. Now, it turns out that a very famous Argentinian author, Julio Cortázar, wrote a short story that Yanez used in her study to show the students how you can manipulate aspect, in which he did exactly that, right? He wrote a story in which he pretty much reversed all of the aspect features of the text to go against what you would normally expect to find in the text. Basically, he was being creative, right? So our thinking is, you know, if writers can do this, then, you know, why not everybody, right? Now we're not saying that everybody's going to become a great writer, but I think if you understand how a system, how a domain works, you can use that knowledge to create something new as a way of not just exploring yourself, but in a sense, creating something new for other people. To create new impressions, to profile, to construe different ways of thinking about what's going on in the world, right? That's the point. So that what we say and what we write doesn't necessarily have to be an exact copy of what's going on in the world. We can we use language to create, to paint, if you will, right? New understandings. And I think that's what Vygotsky was trying to get at in that extensive paper that he wrote on creativity and imagination. And so I think that to me, this idea of creative assessment is really an interesting idea. I think it would present a real problem for, you know, psychometricians who don't like these kinds of, you know, they like standardization. They like They don't like, for them, this would be sort of a, introducing some sort of error measure into the statistics. But I think that's really important to go beyond, you know, the usual. And as Eduardo put it, into becoming rather than just being.
Yeah, and I would add to your comment there, Jim, that, you know, I think, again, this is something that we're thinking about now and that we're grappling with, we're struggling with, but it's, you know, one could easily imagine from an assessment perspective, raising all sorts of questions of, well, so how would you score performance in terms of creativity, right? But I think that that kind of misses the point. I think that it's a much easier thing within an assessment context to be able to say that one is approaching greater or, you know, is farther from control over, you know, using language in our case in ways that are appropriate to the norms and conventions of language use. Creativity is a very different thing. And so I don't know that it is the kind of thing that you would want to score, but it would be something that I think that we would want to see evidence of, right? Evidence of going beyond, evidence of becoming. And this is where it seems that, you know, Bausner and van der Veer's concern is really, really interesting, because it is certainly a feature of Vygotsky's more general writings, that this idea of Aufhebung, right, to use the term, right, this idea of carrying forward certain elements, but in new combination, in new synthesis, and with novelty emerging, right, that there is qualitative transformation, and that this is central to the dialectical process that was that characterized Vygotsky's thinking. And they're asking, so does the ZPD, how does the ZPD take account of this? And it, you know, I think the answer is that it must. Otherwise, it's not clear how you would ever have innovation, whether you would just be left with kind of reproduction, right? Where would innovation come from? So it seems that there has to be a role in it, a role for it in there. But yeah, from an assessment perspective, it's going to be, it's certainly going to raise heckles among, you know, I think more traditional testing specialists. One other thing that I wanted to add too, because I saw in the comments a question about, you know, whether this is like, you know, with young children being creative with language long before they've learned the rules, or maybe we would say the patterns or norms with language. And I, you know, I think that that's something we also want to be a little bit careful with. Because as Jim was saying, it's not kind of just anything goes, but rather it's intentionality, right? It's being intentional with moving beyond what the conventions are, recognizing these are the norms, or if you want to use rules or patterns, right? This is what they are, and I'm going to challenge them. I'm going to push against them. I'm going to deviate from them for a particular purpose. And that was what was really interesting, I think, in the Spanish language example, where you would expect the use of the preterite, but instead I'm not going to use that, right? And here's why, right? Because I want to, in this case, draw the reader or the listener right into the action, or perhaps distance them and create a very sort of, you know, broken sort of sequence of discrete actions, right? This was intentional. It wasn't just kind of accidental.
Yeah, I think a lot of traditional language instruction is really very much concerned about performance, but not very much concerned about understanding the performance that a learner is actually engaged in. And I think the lesson that comes from Vygotsky is that development happens in basically two domains: understanding, conceptual understanding of what's happening and what you're doing and what the principles are, and then actually doing it. Whereas I think in most cases in language teaching, the understanding is not is not even in many cases not even considered, but it's just about getting the right answer, the performance, right? And what we're trying to say is you need both. You need an understanding and you need performance. And Vygotsky, made this comment that a performance without understanding is mindless, and understanding without performance is useless in a sense, right? So the development has to happen in both planes. And that I think we see in Emma, in her creative use of Spanish. And she understands what she's doing. She understands why she's doing it, right? And that, as far as I can see, doesn't figure into most formal assessment instruments that I'm aware of anyhow. And it certainly doesn't play a big role in language pedagogy.
Yeah, and when I also mention related to that, for those of you that don't work in the field of second language learning teaching for adults, right? But I'm sure you have studied, other languages, or French or English or German or Spanish. And it's very much a normative enterprise, right? So you are supposed to look like the native speakers. Or in class, you want to be accurate. Or at best, you want to be complex, right? But is and the way this is taught, even in communicative classrooms, and we don't have time to go into that, but either you go for self-expression, just talking, which I don't think is creativity, as we were saying, right? Which is a basic communicative classroom. You're in an English class, they give you a reading. Okay, let's just talk. Let's talk about hobbies. Let's talk about the weather, right? And communication is constructed just as the expression of ideas, right? Which of course is more than that. Or you go to a more formal, let's call it conventional grammatical class, where you either practice features or you do language analysis or, right? And I think Carmen Yanez's dissertation, what Jim was presenting, is remarkable in that notion of using literature to become aware of these options for expression, right? And using those frames to say things that you wouldn't say conventionally, right? That's where you are, this being and becoming, that's where I see it, right? I think the assessment, as Matt and Jim was saying, is gonna be tough. And it's tough because we don't have much creativity in the classroom these days. Right. So, for instance, the argument will be, why don't we teach writing in a second language classroom through creative writing activities, which is very rare. I mean, there are some courses there, but it's so rare that, I've seen very few things related to learning English through writing poetry. Right. There are some things out there, but it's more the typical course. You will get some essays and you will do analytical writing, argumentation, which is very efficient and it's good for certain things. But it may limit other options, right? You open different zones of potential. I like the notion of potential, proximal. I think there is a spatial metaphor. I like this notion of potential, possibility, right? It opens different possibilities. And I think that the challenge with teaching languages for adults is that the possibilities that are open are usually connected to analysis, expression, being accurate, right? And I always remember connected to one of the first ME theses that I directed in Massachusetts was about personality and second language learning. It was an MA student that was taking students to Spain from the US. I was in the US. And the students coming back to my student and saying, I don't have a personality in Spanish when I'm in Spain. I can say things like declarative, right? You say things, I want to go to the restaurant. I want to eat, right? But that's it, right? And so they were this study, they were saying, I don't have a personality. So we were talking, so what do you mean, right? So we got to this notion of basically voice and connected to creativity. It's not about what you say, it's how you say it. I say these things in a way that is going to be serious, say these things in a way that is going to be funny. Or the other question, these young female students were going to Spanish bars and they were asking, so how do I say you know, leave me alone in a way that is polite but firm, right? So it's about the how, right? Because they don't want to be rude, but you know, you gotta be firm. So that's when I got it, you know, I started thinking about this issue of creativity in the sense of expressing your personality about the things you say, right? And in teaching, we do very few things. I mean, there are some proposals out there, and for sure, I mean, there are teachers that do these things. So I think the challenge that Matt and Jim are saying, taking this to assessment, I think is very much needed, and it may be a solution. Once you have it in the assessment, sometimes you have the worst back effect to the teaching, right? That you want to learn a second language, not just to say things, or even transactions. The whole task-based learning approach is based on completing transactions. I want coffee. I want to get to the library. I want, right? If your life is about transactions,
not much of a life.
Yeah. Right. I mean, yeah. The main transaction is I want to make friends. I mean, I'm directing now a study abroad center here. Yeah. And that's what they still say. You know, I want to have a life. I want to make friends. I want to laugh with them. Yeah. I want to make a joke.
Yeah. I mean, what's missing, and somebody mentioned this in one of their questions, is the whole issue of emotion, right? How do you deal with emotion? I know of no tests that deal with the emotional side of things. And there are very, very few pedagogical approaches about emotion. In the unity, what Vygotsky called pedagogy, right? The unity of the emotion and the intellect. So how do you be emotional in another language? I mean, that's not an easy thing to do. It's not just transferring over what you do from your first language, because it doesn't always work. And that we spend almost no time on, as far as I know, right? How you actually achieve that. And I think maybe some of the work that Olga has been doing, I came across one of your articles. I can't read it, of course, in Russian, but I read the abstract on the use of drama in theater. And I've been sort of translating bits and pieces of it through Google Translate. And it's something that I'm very interested in currently. We're doing another project using improvisational theater as a way of stimulating creativity in language classrooms, particularly in urban areas in the US. We have a project going that's funded by a government grant. And so we're really interested in this whole issue of drama and theater, because it does bring out emotion and stress and tension and leads to creativity. And improv is a really important way of making that happen. And if you know, if you read Newman and Holtzman's book on Lev Vygotsky, Revolutionary Scientist, they talk very much about creativity in childhood that is sort of lost as adults mature and they become sort of normalized as they move into a culture, not just in language, but in other aspects of their behavior. And that's sort of that creativity that you have in childhood is sort of surrendered, if you will, as you move into, and some people of course resist that, the writers and the actors and the painters and so on. But you know, what we're trying to argue for is that there are ways of getting this back through pedagogy. And I think if we don't do that, we're just missing a lot of what matters, as Eduardo says. It's not just about saying things. It's about how you say things that matters a lot. And we spend very little time on that in language pedagogy. And I think Vygotsky might have ways of helping us achieve that. And that's sort of what we're looking at.
It's interesting to me, you know, thinking about it, through the lens of assessment and through the lens of teaching. And I mentioned early on that much of the dynamic assessment work that we've done in the second language field has been in classrooms, because the definition or conceptualization of assessment seems to have the potential to be broader than what we think of as formal testing environments, right? And so, you know, one of the something that stands out to me in classrooms is that we often are asking, if our purpose is teaching and learning, we're often asking students about what questions they have. And that's never included in assessments. And it seems like what a missed opportunity that would be as a way of getting at one aspect of creativity, right? Of, you know, what are you wondering about, right? You've learned this new thing. You know, where does that, what does that stimulate in your own thinking? What kinds of questions does that lead you to wonder about? That's not something that we would ever ask in an assessment, right? But in teaching, we might. And we've really, really disconnected those things in a serious way.
Yeah, there was always the saying in the U.S. education, a mind is a terrible thing to waste. But, you know, it's all about the intellect and the cognition and not about the person. Person is a terrible thing to waste. That's I think, has to be the model of education.
Thank you so much for this discussion. Actually, you know, for me, it's particularly inspiring because personally, I really enjoy learning languages, and I've been learning a few. And in each language, I think the most challenging thing for me has always been this, what I call the lack of color. You know, when you're talking in your own language, for example, when I'm talking in Russian or when I'm reading a book, it seems that the words, they have color, they have connotations, they have these very, very tiny, subtle meanings, which are absolutely beyond the things that you may find in a dictionary or whatever. They're connected with the context, they are connected with the perizhivaniya in different concrete situations that you've lived through. For example, and also with the cultural historical context, of course. Like, for example, if you say water and you translate it directly into Russian, like vada, it's not the same because mm-hmm. the cultural historical context that these mm-hmm. words are triggering, it's always different. And you know, the main question for me was, how can this colorfulness of language can be taught? How it can be given from the teacher to the student, particularly when a teacher is not a native speaker? Like when you're in a classroom, like a Russian student in a classroom where their teacher is from Russian background, you know, and actually for both, this lack of color is quite natural. And I was thinking about the possible ways of solving this problem. For myself, when I was a teenager, I chose a technology of writing. I tried to write poems and stories in English. And I remember very well when I wrote a story, my first story in English, and brought it to my teacher. The teacher took this paper and then gave it back to me a week after, saying, "Oh, you know, I was shocked. There are so many mistakes and tenses." And that was, well, you know, that was not demotivating for me because I was like, okay, never mind. This is interesting and I will keep doing this. But I'm sure that for any other like student that might have been the end of those experiments.
Sure.
Because indeed, creativity is driven out of the classroom. Yeah. There is no place for creativity. Yeah. If you're learning a foreign language, you are supposed to speak like to speak in the right way. And that's the only thing that you should do.
Yeah, whatever the right way is. I mean, that's the problem. Right? I mean, there's a famous quote from Vygotsky where I think it's Pushkin that he cites, who says, and I'm paraphrasing, I'm not sent the exact quote, that Pushkin ostensibly said, "I have no greater love for the Russian language than when it's spoken incorrectly." Right? I mean, that what he's talking about there is creativity, right? That something new is being created, and that it's not just following the norms and the rules, whatever those rules are, assuming that languages have rules, which I don't think they do. So I think it's interesting what you say about native speakers, because native speakers sometimes do not make the best language teachers, because they haven't struggled. with the language the way non-natives have. And on the other hand, they're also, because they're forced into following a certain curriculum, they, you know, they're reluctant in many cases to offer what they can offer, which is the creative aspect of language, the emotional aspect of language, right? And so a lot is lost there because they're sort of forced into a model that says you have to follow the textbook and you have to, and these are the rules that you have to follow and so on and so forth. So the advantage of being native speaker sometimes is missing. The other area that I think is worth looking at, and we've done some work in this area, and that's on figurative language, right? Metaphor, which is a really hard thing to master in a second language. How do you use metaphors creatively? I don't mean idioms, but I mean just metaphorical language is really not easy to do in another language, and to understand metaphors because they have negative and positive valencies. And sometimes, you know, you misinterpret because your culture sees the similar metaphor is negative and the other culture is using it as positive and so on. So we don't have much space for that either, for figurative language, which is really, most of what we say is figurative, it's not literal. So I think that's another area where we can open up some creativity for students.
I would add that I mentioned earlier, you know, in kind of surveying briefly the field of second language studies, I mentioned the influence of Chomsky, who of course was focusing on first language acquisition, but it nonetheless, I think part of that heritage in language studies has been a real preoccupation with structure, right? And we were left with this talking about rules and you know, and getting it right. Well, it's in some ways easier to mark something as right or wrong when we're looking strictly at forms, at language structures. And I think that also goes to your example, Olga, which I really, really appreciate, of trying to create with language and, you know, and not getting a response that engaged with the meanings, right? But it was about the forms. And that's certainly very true in North America. And I think in other contexts as well. And that also, you know, it may have a relevance, at least toward moving towards some of the conventions, right? Gaining control, intentional control over conventions, but that it seems to really be inadequate for thinking about creativity when you divorce or disconnected form and meaning.
Yeah. I mean, I think there are some, what Olga, you were asking, there are some proposals and there are things that you can do as a teacher. I think as a language teacher, and the opportunities that you can create in the classroom. The challenge for teachers is that maybe many of the things that you experience as a student were based on thinking that the learner is a linguist and that sentence level grammar is the way to go, right? But if you think about courses in a different way, so the language learner is an actor, maybe improvisational activities, like scenarios or theater, right? Then you bring to the classroom different things. Or if you think the language learner as an ethnographer, there are some proposals, right? Where language is a social practice and you want to document that and you pay attention to context and, right? So you do different activities with the students. I think the problem, as Matt was saying, we're still very much, we have this implicit framework that we don't question and we just take sentence level examples. And, you know, that just doesn't go. And then the issue is not just the object of language, is how it's being used, the emotion that you want to transmit, who do you become, the image that you are projecting, right? So you got to change the priorities in the classroom, you got to use texts, you got to use the assessment. I mean, I think there are proposals, but most conventional courses, as far as I know, still are very much tied to sentence level analysis.
Yeah.
Conversation, right? Yeah. That's the other extreme, let's talk.
Yeah.
And, right.
Yeah, following up on what you're saying, I think an area, and Eduardo, you've explored this a bit, I know, is this whole notion of language play,
yeah,
of playing with language. That's a really important way of opening up creativity. And we don't allow that because the dominant metaphor that guides most education is the work metaphor. You have to be a good worker. You have to do tasks, right? You're not allowed to play, and play is seen as a bad thing. But in point of fact, play is a really important thing. And we know from Vygotsky's writing how important play is in the development of the individual. And so I think we need to open up space for people to play with language, to experiment, to try new things. And in play, of course, you can take more risks than you can at work, because in work, when you make a mistake, it's costly. But in play, it's usually there are fewer risks, and there's usually very few penalties in getting it wrong, if you will. And so I think that's a really important aspect too that we need to consider. And that's why I think we're interested in improvisation. Improvisational theater is kind of playing around with language. And I think that gives people a different sense of what language is, including their own language, which they're not even, most people are not aware of their own language, right? Because it just becomes invisible. So I think play is really an important aspect as well, that's linked to creativity.
Yeah, and I think if you take that seriously, the genres that you ask your students to practice. So one thing that we may need to do is you need to get rid of essays in classes. Yeah. Because it's not the same activity to write an essay to understand a poem that to write a poem to understand a poem. Or if I wanna, for instance, Guy Cook in language play, he's been arguing about using jokes, right? But it's not the same activity to analyze a joke that I'm gonna create a joke based on an English joke, right? Or these different types of genres. That one that we've been using in Spain is storytelling. Like the students, they need to tell a story when they come to Spain from Russia, from the US, and they have a hard time because for them it's easier to do an argumentative essay. You're used to that. But if you come to Spain and we do digital stories, there is an implicit template. They think they come with no story. There is one that is based on dominant technologies, which is, I'm going to come to Spain, I'm going to take a photo, and I'm going to say I like it, right? Based on or Facebook. And so if the first draft they do of a story is very plain. It's just, I came to Pamplona, I ate tortilla, right? Yeah. So one question from a play perspective is asking the students to do what you were doing is, okay, tell me a story now, but then you need to teach them the template of a good story where there needs to be a conflict, a main character, an antagonist, there needs to be a resolution, right?
Okay.
And then they see models and they change the models, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the students, they need to become writers. Right. Of their own life. It's that's kind of the challenge. It's not about the analysis. It's about telling a story that expresses something that is important to me. But we know that, and we see that in our center in Spain. If we don't teach them to tell a story, most of them, they will just come up with a story. I went to Spain, I had fun, I like chocolate, I hate it, I don't know, something else.
Yeah.
Right? That's the prototypical experience, which is the touristic story. There's a framework for traveling. You go to places, you take photos.
Yeah, it's just reading up the photographs.
Right.
Here we are in Pamplona. Here we are eating tapas. Here we are drinking beer. Here we are.
So it's an Instagram, Facebook story that is constructed.
Yeah.
So I think in education, and this goes more to for adults, we still have a lot to learn, right? To kind of start looking in different places to find ways of telling a different story, right? That is not about new or, which is creativity, is also constructed. And I saw this in Spain that was so fantastic and awesome. Well, so maybe that's not the part of this, right? So we've been exploring some of these things. So the main project is a storytelling project, is not an essay, which is not to say that an essay is it's a very powerful way of dissecting, analyzing, synthesizing, right? But it takes you into a different zone of potential development. And we're exploring these other options.
Right? Well, and storytelling, right, also holds the potential for the writer, right, to inhabit a different role, right, to be something that they're not, right? So as a writer, you're not limited to saying, okay, well, I'm a student doing my study abroad in Spain in order to learn the language and learn about the culture. You could compose your story from the perspective of a local, person from Spain or from, you know, something, you know, whatever it might be, right? I mean, you could take different vantages. And I think that's also a really interesting kind of creativity, right? That allows for playfulness with language, right? In this role, how would I use language in this situation for what would be my ends, right? So there's kind of an acting, right? That would be a role-playing that would be relevant.
That's the value of improv. That's what Holtzman and Newman do in their East Side Institute in New York, that improv is used not just as a learning tool, but as a kind of therapy, psychological therapy, to help people experience what it's like to be other than who they are, right? Instead of just being who I am, being someone who I am not, and to feel what it's like to be different as a way of helping them deal with depression and other kinds of psychological problems that they may have. It's a very powerful tool. There's no question about that.
Yeah. I think the second language experience, when you think about it, it creates a lot of crisis. I see it every semester. I always have a student crying coming from, you know, different countries in my office, because you have a shock. You discover things when you go to a different country and you're in immersion. You discover things. I think that's the connection between second language learning and Vygotsky and psychology and crisis. You see crisis in study abroad settings all the time. positive and, you know, sometimes tough crisis. People who discover things and they don't know how to overcome them. But, you know.
Actually, you know, just a very short remark, because we're running out of time, desperately running out of time. A very short remark about play and theater. Actually, there is a project in our center, a project now, which is devoted to applying theater in school. I will send you the link in chat. So we have a page about it in English. And, you know, I've started to be interested in applying theater for different educational purposes, not only for language teaching, but generally for teaching for a few years. And I agree with you completely that it is probably the most powerful tool, or one of the most powerful and multidimensional tools, which can be applied for, first of all, solving various tasks connected with learning, with development. We can use it for constructing the zone of proximal development at different ages. We can apply it for both for learning content and also for solving the age tasks, the developmental tasks. And it is also applicable at different ages. If we simply adjust it for concrete age peculiarities, we can find very, very interesting solutions. For example, in this project that we're doing now, we are interested particularly on how theater can be applied in adolescence. And here we try to focus on playing with roles, or rather we use the term experimenting with roles, which is particularly important at this age. And it seems that the situation when the teenager is experimenting with roles with the other, with his peers, this is exactly the situation when he or she can both solve developmental tasks connected with socialization and finding the place in the group and constructing agency and so on. And at the same time, acquiring certain learning content, for example, language or history or literature, whatever. So we are trying to use this theater on different subjects and school disciplines, including history and literature and so on. And this is indeed extremely interesting. I think that theater is the technology for future. Mm-hmm. And since we have somehow to sum up and to finish, I'd like to say that I'm now working on a paper for the special issue of the journal Cultural Historical Psychology, which will be published in summer, and where you're all very welcome to publish and where you're all very welcome to contribute. This special issue will be totally in English, and it will be devoted to the coming ISCAR Congress. And the general framework for papers is how cultural historical theory is applied in different countries, in different social and particularly educational practices. I hope that I will be able to contribute with a paper on theater and how the theater is applied in this cultural historical theory paradigm. So I will also leave you a link where you can read about the deadlines and so on. And I hope that also Matthew and James, probably Eduardo, will contribute with the paper. And I hope that we will be able to continue this extremely interesting and enriching discussion, because there are so many moments and so many issues that still remain for further discussion. I'd like to thank you, James and Eduardo and Matthew, for this absolutely amazing talk, amazing discussion. I'd like to thank all the participants for coming, for sending the questions. I think indeed we have very little time for discussing all the comments and questions, but please do feel welcome to continue. So you have the link to our group on Facebook where we can go on with the discussion. And please, I suggest that we don't stop here.
Thank you very much, Olga. I also wanted to, in the spirit of continuing the conversation and the dialogue, to just add two things. I put into the chat a link to a journal that we have, that language and sociocultural theory that Jim and Eduardo and I are involved in. And it's devoted to first and second language studies that use cultural historical theory, Vygotsky's, and rely on Vygotsky's ideas. So that would be a way to, you know, if you're interested in continuing to learn more about some of the work that we're doing, and if you see points of contact and interest. So the link is in there. It's an Equinox journal. And then the other point I just wanted to make was, you know, how much I enjoyed this, and that I'm happy to, you know, continue over email as well. I think our email addresses were included in the announcement that went out earlier. So I'm happy to continue to engage with people that way as well.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And so on your right on the chat, you can find the link to the special issue. And also I've sent a link to the previous special issue, which was also in English. And I hope it will be available for more readers than our Russian editions. We're trying to translate. By the way, the most challenging thing is to find good translators from Russian into English who translate the concept of Переживание not as adventure, which is really, really challenging. So thank you once again for this wonderful evening or morning, whatever, and hope to see you again.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. See you. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you everyone.